Commerce, and I'm really excited to see all of you here today at our Your City, Your County, Your State, and You event. First and foremost, I do want to thank all of our Platinum members. So they, with their assistance, were able to have great large events like this for all of you here today. I do have a few housekeeping notes for you. Please feel free to take photos throughout the event. The hashtag today is #YourCity2021. In addition, MSU does require all of us to be wearing masks, so while you are in the audience, please do wear your mask. That does not apply to the presenters here today, so we can make sure they don't look awkward the entire presentation. So I'd like to move on here, and I would love to thank our event sponsors, our presenting sponsor, Consumers Energy. Let's give them a round of applause. In addition, I'd like to thank our gold sponsor, Beaumont, visionary sponsor, Smart, and you can see their Smart Flex vehicle right outside, and our connecting sponsor, Raymond. Let's give them a round of applause. And speaking of our presenting sponsor, we have our wonderful Lauren Royston, Community Affairs Manager with Consumers Energy. And Lauren, if you'd like to come on up. Lauren is a Community Affairs Manager for Consumers Energy, Michigan's largest energy provider. She proudly serves the Southeast Michigan region, ensuring her friends and neighbors receive the hometown service Consumers Energy aims to provide. Lauren currently works out of the Royal Oak Service Center. She is a community relations and economic development professional with almost 20 years of experience working in government and private industry. Prior to joining Consumers Energy, she served as the community engagement manager for Molina Healthcare and previously served as the director of economic development for the city of Novi. Additionally, she worked as a manager for the State of Michigan Workforce Development Agency. Lauren earned her bachelor's degree from Spelman College and graduated from Wayne State University with a master in public administration, and she currently resides in Novi. And in addition, she is also an amazing woman and a great friend. So Lauren, please join us.
That was so sweet. Hi, good morning, everyone. Okay, so I'm Lauren Royston. Thank you so much to the Troy Chamber for having me here, having us here today. We're always honored to partner with the Troy Chamber. If you've seen me before, you know I always like to share a little bit of information about Consumers Energy so that you get know that we're more than the folks that send you the bill every month, because that process will continue. You're always going to get a bill every month. Sometimes higher, sometimes lower, but you're going to get a bill every month. But we're more than those folks. And so we have provided, Consumers Energy has provided reliable, affordable energy to Michigan customers since 1886. So over 130 years I've been around. And today we are Michigan's largest utility and the fourth largest combined natural and gas utility in the United States, serving 6.7 million Michiganders in all 68 counties of the Lower Peninsula. We own and service 90,000 miles of electric lines, enough high voltage and low voltage power lines to wrap around the earth 3.5 times. Or travel from Michigan to California about 27 times. So just got a lot of lines. And then we also service almost 30,000 miles of natural gas pipelines, which is probably about from Michigan to California 11 times. We own 15 natural gas storage sites, which allows us to buy and store natural gas in the summer when costs are typically lower, and then distribute it to our customers in the winter when costs are typically higher. And our gas storage fields can store 151 billion cubic feet of natural gas. And then we deliver about 356 billion cubic feet of natural gas to customers every year. So we're able to store about 45% of the gas that we deliver to our customers every year. We operate 38 service centers across the state, strategically located to provide service to our customers. As Tara mentioned, I'm stationed out of the Royal Oak Center on 14 Mile and Coolidge, not far from here. We have another Oakland County facility in Groveland Township on Dixie Highway. And then we also have a service center in Livonia on Farmington Road that services the western part of Oakland County. We are the second largest taxpayer in Michigan, behind another company I'm not going to mention, but they also provide electricity and gas as well. And we paid about $475 million in state and local taxes in 2020, about $16 million of that here in Oakland County. In 2020, our charitable foundation, our employees, and our retirees donated more than $19 million to Michigan nonprofit organizations. And of that, Consumers Energy awarded $9.7 million, our largest contribution ever, which included $5.4 million in COVID-19 assistance. And of that $5.4 million, $1.8 million focused directly to provide assistance to small businesses. So that's what I wanted to end with today is I wanted to share that small businesses, that Consumers Energy, we're beyond energy. We support your business. We understand that small business is the backbone of Michigan's economy, and we are committed to helping you prosper now more than ever. And we can provide meaningful and immediate help by working with you on your utility bill, connecting you to potential sources of state and federal relief, providing new business opportunities through the Pure Michigan Business Connect program, finding incentives and instant rebates on a range of clean energy programs that will help you save your money and the planet. So please look us up, consumersenergy.com/business, and we'll connect you with all of our business resources. So thank you so much today for allowing me to share that information about our company. And now,
I'm just gonna press buttons.
Oh, and now I have the absolute pleasure to introduce our moderator for today, Christy McDonald. She is the anchor moderator and managing editor of One Detroit. She also anchors special coverage for WTVS Detroit PBS, including documentaries, live news events, and the Mackinac Policy Conference. McDonald has appeared in numerous times in the PBS NewsHour and CNN reporting on Michigan politics and Detroit's financial crisis. A sought-after moderator, see, we got her here today, yay. McDonald has led lively discussions at the Detroit Economic Club, Detroit Policy Conference, Mackinac Policy Conference, International Women's Day events, and BLM CEO Summit, among others. McDonald also co-moderated gubernatorial debates in 2014 and 2018. She has appeared on WDET, public radio as a guest host panelist, as well as a feature guest on syndicated radio show Remarkable Women and Anything is Possible. McDonald is an Emmy Award-winning anchor and reporter. She connected with Detroit viewers for 10 years on WXYZ-TV, on the big stories from 9/11 in New York to political corruption in the city of Detroit. She has received reporting honors from the Associated Press and Michigan Association of Broadcasters for anchoring and breaking news coverage. McDonald has guest lectured at Michigan State, University of Michigan Dearborn, and Wayne State University. McDonald grew up in Troy and is a graduate of Troy High School. Go Troy High School. She is a graduate of Michigan State University's James Madison College with a degree in political philosophy. And you can contact her on Twitter at ChristyTV.com. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Christy McDonald.
Lauren, that was too kind of you. That was the long version of my bio, so I hope you enjoyed that. Good morning, everyone. It's great to have you here with me. I have to confess to you that the last time I was in this room, I was taking an SAT prep course as a teenager. This is where I came to take the course. I grew up in Troy, so being back here today and being able to speak with Ethan and with Dave and with Ryan is really powerful for me, because I think that we're at this really interesting point in Michigan, and especially in Oakland County, in the city of Troy. And when we talk about this transformative place that we're at, when we look at schools and education, when we look at supporting small business, when we look at growing our population here in the city of Troy and across the state, you can really tell these stories through cities and townships. When we talk about infrastructure, and we talk about healthcare, and where we're going to be putting a lot of the funding that we were receiving from the federal government and also from the state, we can sort of see where all of this will have impact. So I hope, you know, Troy has always been a leader in having conversations about the important issues. So I hope that these conversations are happening around the state in cities and townships, because I think when we convene rooms like this and we start exchanging some ideas and really then sharing the information, because Ethan knows what he's working on in the office and Dave has got 28,000 things happening every day, and you know, and so does Ryan, but when we were able to kind of bring it together in this stage and have this small room and share some of those ideas, then you can bring it out and move it forward. The way I like to moderate conversations is to get the audience involved. So we're going to talk here, we're going to do a Q&A for a little bit, but I would love for you to come up if you have any questions. So about halfway through our discussion, I'm going to turn to you and say, all right, we're going to bring you as part of this conversation as well. So kind of get your questions and some of the things that you find really important or you'd like to hear from these three gentlemen here. So without further ado, you know Mayor Ethan Baker. He is around town and one of the most visible mayors that I've experienced in the lifetime I have lived here in the city of Troy. Ethan, it's great to see you. How about a round of applause for Ethan Baker? Dave Coulter has had one of the hardest jobs over the last 2 years as our county executive to continue to keep Oakland County moving forward in a power transition as well, and then now moving through a global pandemic. This is not easy for public administration, so we are very happy to have Dave Coulter here with us today. And Ryan Michael gives us kind of the global view from a state perspective, and looking at how we're attracting talent, how we're attracting business, and what kind of pieces that small businesses play in the recovery of Michigan and moving us forward as we compete for talent throughout the Midwest and really throughout the country. So Ryan Michael, the Vice President of Growth and Development for the MEDC. It's good to have you here, Ryan. All right, let's go ahead and get started. I find that sometimes the easiest questions are the best questions. Usually people sidle up to me and they say, so how are things really going in Troy? And I would like to ask that question of Ethan. I'm going to start with you and say, so how are things really going in Troy? How would you describe where we're at right now?
It's an easy question, but it's not at all. You know that.
That's anyway, right. Before so I'm going to sit back now.
Let me just say two quick things. Troy Chamber of Commerce is a huge partner for our city of Troy, and we are so thankful that they're doing these events. Great to see so many of you here today. We know that means you care about your community and your city, and we love that the Chamber is continuing to put on these dynamic and, well, hopefully dynamic, events with all of us together, because that it means the world to us to have the partnership with Tara and Sheila, Jody, and Sydney now. So that's first thing. Second thing, Christy, very excited. You're a Troy resident. We love that you're here moderating. The bio, of course, is amazing, but I did want to give a special thanks to all the work you've done for colorectal cancer awareness. We know it's been a huge deal, but we appreciate it very much. Thank you. Leading to how are things going in Troy? You know, I'm a big cheerleader for our city, so the first thing I'll say is Troy's doing great. I love Troy. I love getting out there. I love seeing all the new businesses that are opening. I am doing a lot of ribbon cuttings. There's a lot of movement still coming into our city. You know, we've got a lot of people from the city here today who've worked really hard to make sure we're still marketing our city like it should be to get these businesses to come. And, you know, whether it's a small mom-and-pop type shop to these global leaders that come and choose Troy for a number of reasons. So Troy's doing well from that front, I think. You know, we're always very curious how things are going to move forward. We've got, you know, typically prior to COVID, Troy's population more than doubled during the work week, which fed all of our restaurants and retail shops. You drive down Big Beaver. There's traffic still, because there's always traffic on Big Beaver, but there's a lot of empty parking lots still. So we know that the restaurants and those retail shops and the service dry cleaner type shops are not getting the amount of people that they need. So we're anxious to see how much of this stay at work at home is going to actually continue as we go into a full second year, and whether or not people will be back in the office, because that will make a big difference for our small businesses especially. But, you know, we went through some trouble in Troy a few years ago. I'm happy to say that from that perspective, we're doing really well from a transparency standpoint, from a togetherness, cohesiveness. We've got some council members here today, I think, would attest to the same thing. But we really feel like we're in a positive place to move forward and to lead the county and the region coming out of COVID. So I have to say Troy's doing well.
All right, so Dave, give us the perspective from Oakland County. How are things going? And I think, what are some of your challenges now moving forward? And we had challenges before a global pandemic.
Yeah, thank you. And again, I want to echo what you said. Thank you to the Troy Chamber. You guys are awesome. And Christy, it's great to see you. And our county commissioner for this district, Penny Lubes, thank you for being here. She's a great partner on the county commission with me. And Padma Koopa, by the way, our state representative, I want to give a shout out. There you are. Thank you for all you do in Lansing to help us succeed. So, on the it's a tale of two stories, really, because on the one hand, Oakland County is doing very well. We are, undeniably, the economic engine of Michigan. More jobs are created here on an annual basis than any other county in the state. Our GDP is by far greater than any other county in the state. We take our economy and our businesses and our communities very seriously. And so that continues. And it gave us a foundation when the pandemic hit to be able to weather it differently than some other counties have. And so from a financial standpoint, we're pretty darn strong. I'm very proud of the fact that just last month, we passed our budget. Our budget in Oakland County is just shy of $1 billion, so it's no small task. There's a lot of moving parts. Economic development is part of it, but public health and roads and all of the things that make up county government. And we're doing well. We have a 3-year balanced budget still. We have a AAA bond rating that's been reaffirmed twice since I've been here. We talk to economists all the time to sort of try to get a outlook of where things are headed. So in that regard, Oakland County is still doing really, really well. But as you suggest, there are great challenges, and Mayor, you touched on some of them. In some ways, the economic recovery has been different depending on the sector that you're in. And so we have some businesses that are already back and doing better than they did before the pandemic hit, which is wonderful. Some of them, the pandemic was actually a boon to. You know, I talked to people in the construction industry and in some other industries where they have just thrived during this period for various reasons. But we also know, especially in small commercial and retail and restaurants, and I mean, I don't have to tell you that there are industries that are still, especially small businesses, that are still really struggling. And so that's something that we have to keep an eye on. I'll be honest, you know, a big focus of ours, especially at the beginning of the year, was to try to get our vaccination rate over 70%. The public health people told us that would be kind of an important number to bring this transmission down. I think we lead the state, or we're second in the state in terms of counties, in terms of our vaccination rate. So thank you, everyone who's gotten your shot. But here we are in the fall, and I thought things would look different, quite frankly, with the pandemic. But the Delta variant didn't seem to care so much about our 70% vaccination rate. So it's something that we continue to take seriously. We have to. And yet, we have new tools, not just a vaccine, but we now know how to get grants out to small businesses to support them. We know that mental health is a huge issue that has exploded during this past year, and we're better at getting the resources we need to those kinds of businesses. So we've gotten much more nimble and strategic about getting resources to those industries and those nonprofits that need it, and holding back maybe a little bit from the ones that are doing fine. So, but it's, you know, it's been nothing but challenging. There's no, you know, you got to be honest about that.
And we'll definitely talk about a lot of those challenges. A skilled workforce, training also for higher ed, so an education, K-12, that really comes into the picture as well. Infrastructure, and I love that you mentioned healthcare. One of the things coming out of the pandemic is that we really realized some of the disparities that our communities have with healthcare and access to it. And so how does that change? And then I want to talk a little bit later on absolutely about mental health and the investment there, because that is something that will continue to play out, I believe, over the next several years and how our communities have impacted. Ryan, let me ask you, give us the global view from Michigan's perspective, from the state perspective on investment and kind of where we find ourselves now in emerging from the pandemic.
Sure. Well, first, echoing thanks for allowing me to be up here today, Executive Coulter, Mayor Baker. I want to start by saying the MEDC, as the state, we stand on the shoulders of giants, right? We cannot be who we are without all of you, without our businesses. We cannot be who we are without our partners, our business associations, and of course, our local partners, right? Oakland County, the city of Troy. Our successes are your successes, and our challenges are your challenges. So I don't want to spend a ton of time reiterating a lot of the challenges that you just said, because I think we all know a lot of what they are, right? We feel them, we know family members that have them. The pandemic has been so unique and a once in a lifetime, once in a multi-generation situation that we're all navigating, and we're doing our best to figure it out. I'd say that's the challenge. The good news is I think we're doing pretty well, right? We're figuring things out really well. And I think that alongside our partners, you know, being able to enact some of the programs that we were able to as quickly as we did, we launched 23 new programs during COVID to help get resources into the hands of our Michigan businesses. And our local partners, Oakland County, City of Detroit, had a huge, 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 huge hand in being able to do that. So thank you again for all of your support in doing that, because we know that that's the lifeline that you guys needed at that time. And we're so happy that we're starting to see that progress. From the global view, I'm happy to report that people are extraordinarily interested in Michigan. From my seat, I oversee all of our business retention teams. So all of our BDMs, we cover all 83 counties of the state. We have those folks regionally located so that they can be called upon to more accurately address the needs that are localized to those communities in those areas. And I also oversee our entire U.S. and foreign direct investment team, which is four attraction managers and a host of international contractors covering, if my math is correctly, more than 2 billion people of markets around the world. So, and our pipeline is as robust as I have ever seen it in our 9 years here. So there's a lot more coming, and obviously each one of those projects is different and presents a whole host of things that we have to talk through with those companies, but that's multi-billion dollars worth of potential investment into Michigan. It's tens of thousands of high-paying, high-skilled jobs that are coming into our communities to be able to continue to move the needle forward. I think the challenge, and from that aspect, continues to be a lot of legacy perception issues about Michigan. And I think alongside you all and alongside of our partners, as well as local media and others, to be able to tell the real story of Michigan, and that's entrepreneurship, it's grit, it's responding when the world needs us, right? World War II, we responded when the world needed us. I'm going to say Motown, because I think the world needed Motown at the moment that we had Motown. We have, you know, just COVID, Michigan, 23 new programs and, you know, billions and billions of new dollars back into the economy through that. We responded when the world needed, and Pfizer is a Michigan company, right? So one of the vaccines that's out there is Michigan. So again, we're a leader. I think people are recognizing that. There are plenty of considerations that we have, and there's a lot of work that we need to do harnessing some of the new resources that we have available, but things are looking very good.
So when you say that there's a lot of interest in Michigan right now and that there's possibly millions of dollars of investment, are we looking, is this manufacturing? And you said that there are high-skilled or high-tech jobs. Give us a sense of what some of these jobs could be.
So a few years ago, the MEDC, we changed how we look and work to attract projects. We implemented a new strategic plan. So we try our best to look at potential investment in six areas, of which I'm going to forget some of them. But the big ones are, you know, automotive and mobility. How are we harnessing the future when it comes to the revolution? It's not an evolution, it's a revolution in the automotive industry. And I think Michigan is as primed, best suited, absolute tippy top to be able to capture that investment, and we need to make sure people know about it. Advanced manufacturing and engineering, right? We have one of the highest concentrations, if not the highest concentrations of engineers in the entire world here in Michigan, and people know that. Technology, corporate professional services, you know, and there's two others again, as I promised, I would miss them. But that's really how we're looking, and we're seeing, we identified that because that's how the data told us Michigan is going to succeed, and it tracks very well with those strategic focus areas, which I can provide a link you can share to others so you can see that. It's at michiganbusiness.org.
So it's a little bit of competition in terms of wanting to, you know, bring businesses here to Michigan, and when you're looking at other areas of the country that are attractive, whether it's down south for manufacturing or, you know, competing in the Midwest. Dave, let me ask you from a county perspective, when, you know, we work together as a region and we like regional cooperation, but yet it's like, we want to make sure that we are a place for growth and we'd love for businesses to come and to start here. What is that like?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because I think I have a reputation as being a more collaborative regional partner. I believe that's important, because I think when you're overseas, you think of Detroit as, Metro Detroit is all just Detroit. And so Oakland County benefits when the world perceives Southeast Michigan and Metro Detroit as a positive place to do business. So we have worked hard with our partners in Macomb and Wayne and Detroit to be more collaborative about this. But I also believe, because I'm the executive of Oakland County and not Metro Detroit, that if we are impartial in marketing this region to the world, that Oakland County is going to get its fair share of businesses because of the assets and the quality of life that we have here. I believe that very strongly. So when you guys are impartial and bring people and show people Michigan, I believe we're going to do okay. And here's a couple of things that we're doing about that. So number one is, and if you noticed, all of those industries that he talked about, they require a degree of education or certification beyond high school, certainly, right? If we're going to compete globally in the next generation, we have to up our game educationally. And so one of the things that we leaned in on, even before the pandemic, is we call it Oakland 80. But our goal in Oakland County is to have 80% of our workforce, of our adults, with a post-secondary, post-high school degree or certification by 2030. We're at about 61% now. We want to be at 80% in the next 9 years. It's a heavy lift, but we know that if we're going to be attractive to these companies and these jobs and these great-paying jobs that will help maintain our quality of life, that we have to up our game in the education level. And that's not just a four-year degree, because there's lots of good jobs that you can get with a credential or certification in other industries. So we're leaning in on that to make sure that we have the workforce that these businesses are looking for. So that's one of the ways that we're going to compete in the region. I say compete, but I really believe, here's the other thing, if Macomb County lands a great company, Oakland County people are going to work there. So we got to start, I've talked about this a lot, but reducing these, I think, artificial geographic barriers of DeQuinder and 8 Mile, and start to work more collaboratively with our partners in the region and selling Metro Detroit to the world as the great place that it really is.
Ethan, what is the balance of growth here in Troy when we're talking about smaller businesses, we talk about entrepreneurs, we talk about the mom and pop shops, versus, I mean, we're really unique in this city where you can have those shops, but then you look along the Big Beaver Corridor and you look over on Crooks and you see the different areas where you have corporations that have parked themselves. What's our balance here in the city?
We're very well balanced. Over 6,000 businesses call Troy their home, right? And there is an absolute mix of, you know, a two-person shop to, you know, several hundred world headquarters type. So I don't have the exact figure with me, but I know we're balanced and we continue to be. And you see it in our office buildings still, although for the region tend to have a higher vacancy rate, they still have people in them. They still have businesses that are those larger businesses. And we do see new shops every day. I mean, I think traditionally seems like we're doing a lot more ribbon cuttings for the smaller businesses as of late, but I know there's a new credit union coming to Troy. That's the first time here. That's a bigger footprint. It's really fascinating. We talk about competition, and I guess I am competitive. I mean, I love it when Brian Barnett cuts a ribbon up in Rochester Hills, or Pierre does over Birmingham.
I'm coming for you, Brian.
But it's like, why aren't they in Troy? And the art of the lines you're talking about, DeQuinder, I think Sterling Heights is very different than Troy, right? I mean, we share a border. We're right on the edge of Macomb County. But you're right. Sterling Heights people come and shop in Troy. They eat in Troy. They work in Troy, and vice versa. So we do have to have some togetherness in that respect. But I'm always going to, I mean, for now, Troy is where we got my focus, right? Like, I love, we opened Virginia Tile, 50,000 square foot, their flagship store. They've been in 13 states. You know, they closed their Sterling Heights place and came to Troy and built a new place. And, Mike Taylor over there, I'm sorry, Mike, but, you know, it's a beautiful spot. So I, you know, as much as we do work together, there is a responsibility for all of us to kind of focus on, okay, what can we do to make ours the best? And I think that, I know you're doing a great job. I feel like Troy does a great job of really getting out there. Glenn is out here. He's our economic development, and he's speaking to, you know, businesses who are here now in overseas in Asia. I mean, he does a great job of bringing them here to Troy, and it's because of where we're located, who we are, and the infrastructure we provide, I think, that makes us so attractive.
All right, so we talk about businesses, we talk about new business, we talk about attracting business, but let's talk about, I think, the biggest problem that we're all looking at is making sure that we have the workforce. Talk to me about some of the business owners who have talked to you, Ethan, about, I can't get people to work. There are people, and it's not just in a restaurant. It's also in corporations that people are saying, hey, guess what? The last year and a half was really crazy for me, and I've decided to completely change my career trajectory. I've decided to completely go off in a different direction, and maybe I'm going back to community college and getting a different kind of degree. But there's a lot of change, and our future of work is going to look very different here. But what are business owners telling you about trying to get talent, trying to get people to fill the shifts?
They're struggling. Every ribbon cutting we do, we're right next to a sign that says, you know, we're hiring, right? And that's these new businesses there. And you see with the smaller business or the family-run businesses, You've got the family members who are working 12, 15-hour shifts if it's like a restaurant or coffee shop, and or you see businesses, well, we got limited hours to start out, and that's tough for the business. It's also tough for the residents and the people who are the consumers because there's no certainty anymore of when a Starbucks is going to be open. I mean, right? I mean, I hate to, it always comes back to Starbucks for me, but no, it matters, and I think you see it across the board. And people are constantly, you know, I know they work with the chamber a lot to try to get their jobs boards and try to attract people to come in, but I think it's incumbent on all of us to continue to say, you know, let's get employees who aren't traditionally from this area to come here and move here. We do a great job with our, obviously the Troy schools are great. You're a product of the Troy schools. I've got our superintendent here, Dr. Macheski. And, you know, a big part of why people move to Troy and will end up working in Troy is because of our schools, and we know that. So again, a partnership with them is very important. But it's a matter of, trying to find people who are ready to work, want to come to work, have childcare available so they can work. You know, you can't work in a coffee shop from your Zoom at home, right? I mean, that's a big issue, and we recognize that. And I think we're lucky here in Troy that we are an attractive place to begin with. So people want to work in Troy and come here. So we're probably not as bad as some of the other places in the county, and certainly the state. So it's a mix, you know. Yeah. We're working hard.
Well, so then, Ryan, give us a sense of what the MEDC is doing, because, again, you can promote the state all that you want, but if you don't have the talent here to be able to then fill the jobs for the company that just came here, you've got an issue. Talk to me about what's happening to change some training or to educate people in a different way or to get that skilled workforce that we seem to be missing right now.
Well, I think to the issue, there's really two components to it that I see, right? One is identification. So what are the opportunities out there and what are the gaps? And then the second is attainment that Executive Coulter already alluded to. So I think from the attainment standpoint, I mean, the governor has been very aggressive about her 60 by 30 plan. She's announced the Michigan Reconnect program. She's announced the Future for Frontliners program to help get people educated, certified, whatever they require to be able to pursue the thousands of job openings that we have and that we potentially have in the pipeline. I think, though, that there's still plenty of identification going on, and even with all those amazing things happening with the support of our local partners, there's still a gap that we need to continue to work on. The issue, there's no silver bullet, right? So we need to just continue to speak with you all. We need to speak with our businesses, and it's one thing to say, I need an engineer. It's like, well, that's great, but like, you know, what type of engineer or what is the problem? I mean, I just had mentioned we have the highest concentration of engineers, but we don't want to be poaching from each other. So we need to actually, move that education up further, into the system and really exposing kids to new opportunities from a much earlier age. And I know Oakland County, Macomb County, other counties, Manufacturing Day every October is a huge opportunity to just get the visibility out there so that we could talk to kids about careers in advanced manufacturing. I think, I'm of a generation where my parents wanted me to be a doctor or a lawyer. I'm sure many of us are in the same boat, and that's great. Those are excellent professions, but, you know, there's a lot of debt that goes into that as well, and, you know, seeing the life that a lot of people who manage, not just run, it's manage a process, an assembly line, or a CNC machine, and the programming and the sophistication that goes into it, that was lost on me through my life up until I started my career. And I think that's an issue that we want to work with our partners throughout state government, including Leo, the Department of Labor and Economic Opportunity, who's laser focused on helping us do that. So we actually have internally an MOU with the Department of Leo to work on identifying these challenges and begin assigning solutions.
So, Dave, sometimes it's hard for people to even realize what resources are out there and available for them to either switch careers or be trained for those next-gen careers. What is Oakland County doing, and what kind of resources does the county have to help this workforce and get more people into these jobs?
Well, I hope this audience knows that we run 6 Oakland County, Michigan Works offices, and these aren't the old unemployment offices of my youth anyway. These are places where you can go to get connected to the training that you need, the education that you need, the jobs that you need. And so they're very important and valuable resources. And Jennifer Llewellyn, who runs those for us, does a fabulous job. But this issue that you bring up of talent is so complex, and there's so many pieces to it that we could talk about it all day. But I want to, in addition to our Oakland 80, which is why we're doing that program, I want to just quickly talk about two pieces of this that I think we have to recognize. Number one, our young people, we're investing in them in our public and private education to get this education, to go to college, to do all the things, and then they leave the region when they graduate. And far too many of them do that. And so we have got to do a better job of offering the kinds of quality of life that young people, young families are looking for. Because it's a huge disinvestment when we spend all of that money, all that tuition money that went to Michigan State, which was my alma mater. And then we train those people, and then they go to LA or Chicago or somewhere, and then they get the benefit of our investment. We are not growing as a region as quickly and as much as we need to be. And I will also point out that over the last 10 years, we wouldn't have grown as a region at all if it hadn't been for foreign-born residents. So we've got to treat our foreign-born residents with more respect that they deserve, because in communities like Troy and across Oakland County, it has been these foreign-born residents who have contributed to our economy, contributed to our quality of life, and we need to recognize that. So we need a broad quality of life strategy to attract young people to stay here in Michigan. That's number one. And my second point was going to be, but I was so passionate about that one, was...
It happens to me all the time. I'm like, and another thing.
And another thing.
Doggone it, I had it. Really, I did. But that's a complex issue in itself, because that means investments in quality of life things, right? You know, when I was mayor of Ferndale, I use this story a lot. If you go to Ferndale, you see a lot of bike lanes. Every time we redid a street, we put a bike lane on it. Older folks didn't like that so much. It makes traffic a little more challenging. And I'd say, look, we're not doing that because Mayor Dave Coulter is a big bike enthusiast. I'll ride my bike, but this is not my passion. But we listened to the people, the younger families, that said, what do you want in this community? And that was one of the things that we heard loud and clear. And it attracts them there. So we have to do a better job of listening to the folks that we need to attract here in Michigan.
You know, it makes a lot of sense, and it makes me harken back to something that Ryan said in the beginning of the conversation, that Michigan is an attractive place inherently, but we have to do this job in making sure that more people know and really raise the population census. Dave has figured out what he wanted to say.
I figured out my second one. I'm sorry, I'll say it
I'm
really
I'm so
briefly.
Good at reading body language.
You were so good at that.
Yeah.
But because of who is in this audience, I have to say this. I'm sorry, but I had kind of an epiphany moment a couple of weeks ago. I'm talking to the president of the Michigan Restaurant Association, and you know, restaurants have nobody's been harder hit than restaurants, right? So how do you get employees? And we had a very candid conversation about this, and he said, I'll tell you what, some restaurants are doing much better than others, and what it comes down to is those restaurants who before the pandemic treated their employees the best. They were responsive to their needs. They were good employers. They treated them like family. When things came up, they were flexible. And one of the things we're seeing is that those companies who had built that kind of a relationship with their employers and with their employees are having an easier, not easy, but an easier time. And I think this goes across industries. So I would say that if you're the kind of business, and I know nobody in this room is, that just sort of treated your employees like a line item of wages on the budget, those are the ones that are having the greatest time. Their employees today, as you mentioned, have different needs and wants. They need more flexibility. They have different desires. And we as people who employ people have to be more responsive to what employees want these days.
Responsive, and so I'm gonna piggyback off of that and ask you, Ethan, responsive to what people want. And when I think about the city of Troy and you wanting to grow the population, people want to be in a place that they find diversity is important, that education is important, that there is that recreation and green space is important. So give us a sense about kind of what, and I know in working with the council and with the city manager, a bit of a 5-year plan for the city of Troy to continue to enhance a lot of the services that the city has and availability to the residents here, and to make it really attractive, not just for the people who already live here, but to maybe bring some younger people in, because I know sometimes at Troy we skew a little older.
We do, and you know, it's quality of life is a huge part of what we do at the local government level, right? I mean, that's our main focus. You know, I think public safety, obviously, number one, that's our big thing, and we deal with infrastructure as well, but the quality of life issues, those are unique things that the city of Troy can do that Dave Coulter can't do at the county level, because the county's so broad and diverse compared to our city. You know, we are working on a kind of a long-term plan We've got some strategy sessions coming up next month, actually, where we intend to focus a good portion of that on what we do, because we see we've got great facilities, we've got great parks, we've got a lot going on for us from that standpoint, but everything's getting a little tired. Everything is, you could use a little bit of refresh. Do we need to look at what's attracting a younger crowd to recreate in Troy versus maybe that older crowd, who's made Troy what it is, so we never want to take anything away from them. And yet we struggle with what happened in the Great Recession, 09, 10, 11, those budgets, things got obliterated at the local government level from a budget standpoint. A third of our workforce was laid off.
Didn't get a lot of help from the state either. Well, I mean, your revenue sharing.
Right. Yeah, and revenue sharing is still down. I will say Representative Kupa, she's a big advocate for state shared revenue. So I thank you, Padma, for the work you're doing on that. Always trying to get more of our tax dollars back to us so we can use them directly with the people that we represent. But it's a struggle to try to figure out what makes sense from a pickleball. I can't believe I'm talking about pickleball. My council laugh here. But pickleball.
We just took a left turn.
I just went to pickleball because it comes up as something that is an activity that is important to a certain population in our city. But then we've got cricket, which is big in the Indian community. People want cricket. And we've got all these other needs and everything in between, but we only have so many dollars. Right, and so we are struggling with how do we make that work? How do we get the most bang for our buck for everybody? And we look to our partners at the county level, and if you want to give us some money to put in some extra bike lanes and paths, we'll take it anytime. That's something we can work on. But we are really limited, and we have the lowest millage rate in the area in the city of Troy, which we're very proud of and people love. But sometimes you need some more money to do the things that people like also. So trying to find that balance of what the community will respect and take versus, you don't want to try to put a millage out there for recreation or something that's just going to get obliterated at the polls. So it is a constant struggle. But we're looking at 5 years trying to match the quality of services we think the city of Troy residents want and deserve and also will attract new people in. I mean, it really is a primary focus for us. Last point on that. Prior to COVID, all we heard about was green space, green space, green space, green space, right? I mean, if you did a word cloud, green space would be huge. Now, of course, it's COVID. And Troy's built out in so many ways, yet we do have 1,000 acres of green space and city-owned facilities that people don't always realize, right? And but we have to find a way to work with the development in our city to maintain some of the green space that people love, but also continue to grow and thrive from an economic development standpoint. You got to have both.
So you bring up the next great point, and I want to say I'm going to open it up to questions in about 5 minutes. I just have this one question for Ryan, and then I'm going to go to Dave on it. It's the money. We've heard a lot about this infusion of the COVID relief funding. We've got millions and millions of dollars that I would say is once in a generation spending. And then what do we do with this money to be able to impact some serious change within the parameters that the government has given us? Ryan, give us a sense of what that funding means to the MEDC and what conversations you're having about that right now.
Sure. If I can just very briefly go back to the last point, though, a call to action. We are our best salespeople for the state of Michigan. We're Midwest modest, right? So when we talk about, how great Michigan is, we're just like, oh, yeah, it's good. We say, oh, it's got a low cost of living, which it does. And we know why it's great. It's why we're here. But other states, like, is anybody here from Texas? I don't want to offend anybody. Okay. Hook 'em horns, and I don't see your affiliation, but the reason I say that, though, is when you talk to a Texan, they love Texas, and they will let you know about how much they love Texas. And I see the heads nodding, which means I'm not far off, and I think I want us all to, kind of take that mantra back for the state of Michigan. Being a Metro Detroiter, I have a huge affinity for the city of Detroit, Grand Rapids, but we have amazing assets here that we can talk about, but we only talk about it with quality of life, right? So just encouraging everybody to find your best way to sell home in every conversation that you can. To your question now, apologies for the diversion there, but...
it's okay, Ryan. I'm used to keeping people in line when they don't answer my questions.
The unfortunate part is I'm going to give you a classic non-answer that we're still figuring it out. There is so much money that has been made available, which is incredible. I think all three of us can agree that we've been strapped for cash in so many different ways in ways that we can bring each other along, whether it's locally at the county level or at the state level. We're trying our best to figure it out. I know some of those cash dollars have gone directly to Oakland County, directly to the city, directly to Kent County, Macomb County. So I know, I would imagine you guys are having similar conversations trying to figure it out. But I think that we're also noticing, you know, within the market, what we need to attract new deals into Michigan, right? And we have, again, a revolution in our marquee industry. How can we perhaps deploy some of those monies there? I do know that we've worked with the EDA on, you know, deploying new programs for our companies here. I know there's more dollars made available. We just actually assigned a person at MEDC to look at federal opportunities so that we can be more proactive in pursuing and coordinating all those efforts. So certainly not to avoid your question, but there's so much happening at the level, and I'm glad that you're nodding, so it doesn't look like I'm just kind of avoiding the question, but like, there's so much happening. We are working, I promise you, our very best to make sure that we're deploying those resources responsibly and in a way that impacts the highest number of people to generate more revenue for the state, create good jobs and good pathway jobs so that people can move into sustainable careers and make living wages. And again, just do so as quickly as possible, knowing that we have this opportunity in front of us.
Dave, you guys have millions, and you've already started to deploy some of that money. Tell us about some of the plans that you have and what Oakland County has already done.
Yeah, and it's unnerving how much money there is. I mean, I've been in an elective office, first as a county commissioner, then a mayor, and now county executive for almost 20 years now. And most of that time, as the mayor alluded to back in the Great Recession, was how do we do more with less? How do we figure out what services to provide while cutting as little as possible, or you know, not affecting the core services? And now this is an amazing moment in time. This is really a once in a generation opportunity. So we look at it that way. We want to get the biggest bang for our buck. So we want to do sort of transformational investments that will make a difference for decades to come if we can do that. And we have that opportunity to do that. And so I think we have a responsibility to do that thoughtfully and strategically and not rush into just throwing money out the door. Last year when we got the CARES money, that money had to be out by the end of the year, and it was directly for COVID-related emergencies. So some of you got business grants or other things for that. That was by design a very quick process. But this is a three-year process because I think the feds wanted us to be thoughtful about this. And so what we're doing is we did get a certain amount of it out the door quickly, and I appreciate our county commission that did that. We're going to get ultimately $244 million from ARPA funds, and that's a lot of money, folks. And so what we did is we asked the county commission, we said, give us $27.5 million now for what we're calling acute needs. We know that there are still issues with our small businesses. Mental health services is huge, and I know you want to talk about that, and that's huge, and the education and workforce training. So we knew that there were some sort of crises still in those areas. So we're getting those monies out the door right now. But for the rest of it, we're being very intentional. We're talking with the state, because one of our philosophies is if we can leverage money that the state is doing, then maybe we can double the impact. Or what are our local communities doing? Because unlike CARES, ARPA money does flow to the communities.
Yeah, so you're not making a decision in a silo.
That's right.
Yeah.
We're trying to figure out what's everyone else doing. Maybe we can, you know, do a matching program where we can maximize the impact. What are the buckets that we need to really lean into so that we can make these big transformational investments? So we're still working through that thoughtfully, but we have a little bit more time to do that, fortunately. So it's a great problem to have, how to spend this kind of money.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's go ahead and we're going to open it up to questions. So if you have a question, just go ahead and raise your hand. And if you can just stand up and say it nice and loud.
Speaking of our state rep.
Good morning. As a state representative, I do not have sway over federal level issues. We know that immigration reform is very necessary. Senator Peter's office says, I am the state representative, the state legislator, that sends them the most pass-through from all the immigrants across the state seem to have identified me as the immigrant in the legislature and reached out to me. But country backlog is an issue that we face in Oakland County, particularly in Troy, with so many immigrants. Is this something that you are aware of? Is this something that you can also advocate alongside me? And just to give you an idea, I get this information from people in the community, but also from John Oliver. He does a great piece on, kind of humorous, but kind of true, about how people from certain countries because our legal immigration system is based on the number of people per country, and so the allocation to people of Indian origin is very limited compared to the number of people who come over. And so some people are waiting, their children are aging out and have to get themselves deport themselves. That's what's happening. So.
Thank you for that question. Dave, you want to take that from the county level in terms of coordinating any kind of services?
Yeah, well, we are in contact with our federal partners, and the state rep and I have had this conversation as well, but as I alluded to earlier, I think that getting a reasonable immigration policy in this country, now reasonable is subject to debate, and there's a heck of a lot of debate going on that on the federal level. You know, this is one of those issues that I wish we could see more bipartisan support on, because I do think that if we can grow our population and our foreign-born residents and get more foreign-born residents into this county and this region, it would be helpful for this region. There's a lot of talent out there and a lot of people that want to come here for a lot of reasons, and so I think that's a critical piece of this. And Mayor, I would defer to you as well, because Troy is one of those cities that, you know, is it 24% foreign-born?
Closer to 28%.
28% foreign-born residents in Troy, and I think that's a startling number, because sometimes when we think of Oakland County or when we think of the city of Troy, We don't realize the importance and the value that they bring to our communities and what they have added to the fabric of life in our communities. And I think that the rep brings up a great point.
And just
go ahead.
I won't speak too much more on that, but I think we're acknowledging it more than we ever have, and we're starting to consider it and find ways to get people of all countries, all cultures into the jobs that are currently available. We do have partners that are doing amazing things, though. There's Global Detroit in the city. There's the Office of Global Michigan, formerly the Office of New Americans, I believe is the formal title. But we're working our best with those groups throughout the state to help, you know, with the H-1B visa permitting, or, you know, to get people matriculated through. And I think that it's come much more to the fore about how we need to be collaborating around that. So working alongside with you all, and of course, you know, all of you, to understand where those needs are and how we can continue to do that is going to be kind of a tad amount of importance there. But just to let you all know that those resources do exist in as it stands. We just need to be more coordinated, I think, on multiple levels.
Thank you for the question.
Padma, it's a good point. And one of the struggles I face as a mayor with very little power on anything like that, in fact, nothing. The best I have is my name and my ability to write a letter or sign a letter or something. But we look at the complexities of all these different levels of government, and the people and the residents who are the most approachable are us here in Troy, right, and the local level. And yet we have the least ability to do anything about it. And so we have to go up all these chains to try to get. And I think it's an awful thing for our residents especially. The other problem, I think, and the difference for Troy residents specifically, is most of the rhetoric relating to immigration reform is with our southern border, which is not who our immigrants are here in Troy, right? Those are not, so they get lumped in to a category that is frankly just wrong. And I think it does a great disservice to all the people who are here. 28% foreign born. You look at our schools, I think our students are, it's a much higher number than that in many schools. So we really have to look at, it's a global issue. It's not just one border that we need to deal with in this country. And trying to get that point across, you can't differentiate, is the other difficulty. But it's really a struggle.
It's our community. One more question, two more questions. Yes, hi.
Karen Greenwood, Troy Community Foundation. I'm also a realtor, and we haven't talked much about two very important things: the housing crisis that we're in for affordable housing, and we also haven't talked about skilled trades. We can't deliver houses because not only are we only building $500,000 and $600,000 houses, but we can't finish them because we can't get the wood, we can't get the carpenters, so we can't get appliances delivered. So I have 2 points. I just want to say thank you for thinking about stacked living. It is really important, bringing more apartments, bringing more condos. I know that every single neighbor loves that, but we do have a housing shortage and a crisis for affordable housing, and I'd just like to know what you guys think about that.
Who wants to take that?
Can I jump in first?
Please.
Let me jump in first. You're absolutely right, and people don't often think about this, because Oakland County is successful, it's prosperous, it's wealthy. 40% of our residents are qualify as housing insecure, which means they're spending too much of their annual income on housing. And we know why. I mean, look at the value of housing. So we know that this is a huge issue, and we are leaning in we have a community and housing department that is one of the things we spend our first $27.5 million on is helping to get assistance to people who have housing assistance needs, because it's really an important issue. Once again, my second point, the second part of your question, though, housing and
skill trades,
thank you very much. Wow, I haven't had enough coffee yet this morning. So when I mentioned the Oakland 80 program and that not everyone needs a college degree, that's exactly who I was referring to. You can make a great living in this state and in this county with a skilled trades. So I've talked to the leaders of the skilled trades, some of the carpenters and the electricians unions and whatnot, and they said we're begging for people. We have apprenticeships where we'll hire someone for $40 an hour right out of high school, and while we train them, they'll make $40 an hour, and then after the apprenticeship, they make more. And we can't find enough kids out of high school to do that. And I said, well, what's the issue? And they said, honestly, the number one issue is parents believe that their kids need to go to college to have a successful life. And most often, it's their parents or some adult that tells them, you don't want a blue-collar job. So we need to do a better job through our schools, through our ISD, through apprenticeship programs, and educating parents, frankly, to help people understand that you can make a great living, have a great life, and raise a good family on an income in the skilled trades and other kinds of non-college degree jobs. They're out there, and they're great jobs.
That's even something that Ryan was saying, exposure to different things and different jobs. Thank you so much for the question. Is there another question? I want to try to get in like two more. Hi.
My name is Christy with Lake Michigan Credit Union. And a lot of people come into our branch and are just really struggling with the inflation issue. And I just wanted to have your opinion on, because we keep hearing that it's going to get worse. But those people that have two working parents and their income is just flying out the door for buying dinner. So, what's your opinion on that?
Who would like to take that? Who are the economists among us would like to take that?
No, certainly.
It's good. We're all dealing with it.
Absolutely, it's a great question.
We're gonna give it to Ryan.
Yeah. I'm certain.
Seems like he's the man for the job.
I think I can't answer your question. Is the problem? I know. Because I think we all have our thoughts on the inflation. We all see it happening. What's important for us, I think, at MEDC is at whatever level, right, the individual, the business, the macro level, is making sure that we have tools available to support in a variety of ways, right, the wraparound services. Your question's a very big one, and I hope it's not, I'm not trying to float over top of it, but I think that there's a lot of things happening at the federal level with rate setting, and they're trying to work through a lot of that. That's, I'll leave to those folks. But as far as MEDC is concerned, right, I mean, how is it accessing business loans, okay? Or, availability of resources, right? I mean, cost of lumber. I tried to get a fence installed in my backyard, and the cost was ludicrous just because of how the supply chain has impacted that for me to install, So, I mean, inflation is everywhere. So how are we working with our partners like the Small Business Technical Center, SBDC, Development Center, the Procurement Technical Assistance Center, to be able to line those resources up for folks to be able to continue to thrive in that regard. So again, apologies for not, I think, addressing the part of the question that you really wanted or needed. I think it's above my pay grade to be able to do that. But just so that it is something that we're watching from an economic development standpoint, and making sure that we're working with our whole suite of wraparound services at the various levels to make sure that any barrier that we can work to remove, we are working through it.
I think it's a good answer, and I think it's also understanding and finding where those services are available, those wraparound services. So if there is that stress of money, it's like, so where is the stress coming down? Do we need mental health services? Do we need something extra that's going to be able to help with putting food on the table? Where at the county can I access that help? Where at the city level can I access that help? So I know that doesn't totally answer the question, but it is part of a larger conversation. Thank you. One more question. I had my back to this side, so I'm going to go right over here.
Thank you, Kyle, with T&I Credit Union. And actually, really quick to touch on that, because I thought about, but what are we doing on the education side about finance, especially in school? Because a lot of times we will see is students coming out of school don't have that education It's not being provided to them financially. So when they get out of high school or out of college, that's when they struggle. My question, want to be with marijuana related businesses popping up more, becoming more popular, how are we using that industry that's now growing in the state of Michigan towards the economic growth and development of the state itself and the plans in that?
Interesting. Who would like to take that?
Can I start?
Yeah. Oh.
Two things. First, I'll start. We did a ribbon cutting, ironically, with a
if you start with two things, you got to remember.
I'll remember the second one.
I don't know if that's going to happen. I've got a 50-50 on this one.
I'm good. No, I forget. See, that was intentional.
You people are killing
me. We did
me.
A ribbon cutting for a business, Piggy something. But it's all about financial, teaching those financial lessons to students and to people who are not necessarily underage, but who are adults who need some help. It's an online course program, and it's a great thing people do, and we really need to do a better job of promoting those kind of businesses because it's a huge issue. We have kids, we have three kids, and I promise you they would have no idea what to do with a checkbook, let alone really money management at this point. And we try to teach them as best we can. So I hope our school district can partner with those kind of programs to really get that out there for the students, because back to the inflation quickly, now I'm on three things. Back to the inflation, you know, we've got generations now of people who really have never experienced inflation like we're about to have it, or interest rates that are more than, you know, 3% on a house. You know, when I was a kid, when Ellen and Mike Hoderick bought their house, I bet they paid a lot more than 4% interest for their mortgage, right? I mean, it's people are gonna go through a shock. They're not gonna understand what hit them. That was one and two. Number three, marijuana. I got to tell you right now, I think it's great for some communities and some ways for a community who's really struggling to earn some extra revenue. I don't think it's right for the city of Troy. We're a unique community where we are doing fine in many other sectors. The city of Troy is where people are here for their families. They're here for their schools. They're here for we're a huge business community, but with also a bedroom community feel. Hazel Park, for example, I know they're doing really well with it, or at least they think they are. It's helping their bottom line. So I think it can play a role in certain communities that really need it. But in Troy, for example, I don't think we do. And I think people always need to remember, one, marijuana is, it's still classified a certain way at the federal level, but there are extra resources that are required for policing purposes on these local governments. And so any money you might get from that revenue could go directly to your police department for the extra security that they need to provide. So, I mean, there's definitely a place to work with it there, but Troy, for example, I don't think is right.
Anyone else want to comment on that, or are we going to... We're going to wrap it up, okay, because your time is very valuable. I'm going to give you each a minute, and you get to leave us with what your parting words, what we want to take away from everything we've talked about, and I'm going to start with you down there, Ryan.
Oh, boy. I think my biggest pitch was, like, again, I mean, we are humble Midwesterners, but we are our best salespeople, right? We are closest to our communities. We're closest to our businesses. We know... how Michigan is revolutionary and evolutionary, right? And how we are the best prepared to kind of take the next step, especially as COVID continues to go away, right? Like, get out of here. But, it's still a reality. But as we're looking at new opportunities coming in, new resources that we have available, it takes collaboration and communication to the extent that we can answer questions that you have, to the extent that we can help connect you to resources throughout the state. The MEDC prides itself on being a front door to a very broad enterprise of services at the state of Michigan and throughout the state. Again, 83 counties, right? And there's so many layers. This is just one city, you know, the layers of one city. Imagine multiplied over, you know, the hundreds of cities in 83 counties that we have to be able to stack those services to be able to serve you appropriately. At the end of the day, we work on behalf of 10 million Michiganders. That's what we say every day to every customer. That's what drives us. My personal mantra is everybody's my customer, whether it's Executive Coulter or Mr. Mayor or any of you. I want to make sure that I'm always providing a top level of customer service by understanding exactly who you are as a person, what you need as a business. And I think that just is, we need to be kind to each other. And I hope that that's where we're going.
All right, Ethan, what are your final thoughts you'd like to leave everyone with?
I like kindness. Kindness was a good place to jump off.
We need it more.
we do. And I think for me, a big thing, I talk about it a lot, is relationships and relationship building and the importance of those relationships. So we're coming out of a time where we're not used to these in-person things again. We're getting back to them. We've talked a little bit. You mentioned it, Christy. But the value of getting to talk with people in person in the third dimension and actually remembering why you like people, number one, and the things that you can do to better your community or your business, I think that's a huge key. So focusing on those relationships constantly is so important. And that goes for us too. I mean, there's a lot of interplay that I think the county and our city can be doing probably better, and at the state level as well. But like you said, you've got 10 million people to worry about. You've got, what? 1.3 million. I've only got 90,000, so or 89,000. So, I mean, it's easier for me, I guess. But, you know, we really do need to work together to figure out what's going to work best for everybody. And so it is incumbent upon all of us to continue to find ways to come together to work on those relationships, because we'll get a better product for everybody in the end. But relationships, relationships, relationships.
Dave, you get the last word on this.
Wow, okay. So you said we need to be a cheerleader for the state, and so I'll start by being a cheerleader for Oakland County. This is an amazing county. It is diverse, and not just in its people, but in the quality of life that you can have here. Everything from an urban experience to a suburban to exurban to rural, wonderful schools, great quality of life. So we're very blessed, and I'm gonna champion that. I'm gonna rah-rah that. And because we're speaking to sort of a business crowd today, I want to say this. In terms of how I look at Oakland County government, it's not unlike, it's different than a business, but it's not unlike it in this regard. Number one, you have to have your finances in order, right? You can't run a good business if you have sloppy finances and you're not taking care of your financial bottom line. So I'm proud of the fact that we have a balanced budget and a AAA bond rating and all of that stuff. That's the foundation. But I also believe that you can't grow and have a successful business, for instance, if you can't cut your way to prosperity, that you do have to make strategic, important investments where you see opportunities to grow and to prosper. And that's what we're trying to do in Oakland County. We have all of these wonderful assets, and now we have this financial boon that's come. So keeping our financial house in order, what are those investments that we can make that can make this county even better, that can make this state grow? Because 1.3 million people is larger than 9 states. So this is a big, important place, and it's important for if Michigan's going to do well, that Oakland County do well. So I think we also have this obligation to take these funds, to take this opportunity, to make critical investments for our future, and that's the balance that I'm always trying to achieve.
All right, and so your homework assignment is to keep this conversation going. Bring something that you learned here today or that you heard today that was really interesting, and bring it to someone who was not in the room. Keep the conversation going, because we are only as good as the people that we surround ourselves with and the areas that we live in and are able to identify what, you know, what Dave said, the things that make it important for the places that we live. How do we want to be? How do we want this region to be 5 years from now, 10 years from now? And it's incumbent on us. So round of applause for Ryan Michael, Dave Coulter, Ethan Baker. I'm Christy McDonald. Thanks so much to the Chamber. Tara, we'll send it back over to you.
Thank you guys all so much. And I'm going to just kind of piggyback off what Ryan said. I'm not from Texas, but I am damn proud to be in Michigan, in Oakland County, and in Troy, Michigan. So thank you all so much. Thanks again to all of our panelists, and Christy is moderating. Guys, just a few things to note. Again, the hashtag, I saw a bunch of you taking pictures, is #YourCity2021. The Troy Chamber does have some upcoming events that I'd love to share with you. Representative Koopa, actually, it's not on this list, but there is going to be a small business roundtable discussion on Monday coming up. The link will be on TroyChamber.com, so please take a peek. That'll be at 4 p.m. We have November 11th, our nonprofit network conference. This is virtual, presented by PNC Bank. There's usually about 150 nonprofits that are participating in this event. It is a very big event. Lots of education to be shared. As we talk about businesses, we mustn't forget about our nonprofits, who also had a pretty pivotal year. So please tune in for that. November 19th, our CEO series breakfast featuring Tim McGrain, CEO of M1 Concourse, presented by Beaumont. My goodness, that space is amazing, and maybe we can talk him into going to a race car. And then finally, our last large event of the year, which is our holiday luncheon. We were not able to have a holiday luncheon last year, so we are going big. We are going strong. We are all excited, so please come to the holiday luncheon. For any upcoming information, please go to TroyChamber.com. And on behalf of the Chamber and everyone here, it's just so good to see so many faces. I hope you all learned great things, and we are so grateful that these panelists were able to share all this wonderful information with them. So thank you so much, and have a great rest of your day.